On
Give
that
Duke a
good
little more than he needs
old
tonight.
gospel ship, ooh, and we'll go
Sailing.
sailing through ship comes in, ooh, I'm gonna leave this old world of sin, ooh, and we'll go sailing through the air. Trouble in my way, trouble in my way. I have to cry sometime, I have to cry sometime. There's so much trouble, y'all, trouble in my way. I've had to cry sometime, I had to cry sometime. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gifts that have been brought to the storehouse, God. Lord, most of all, bless the giver. Lord, bless those who had a heart to give and may not could have given, Lord. Lord, we ask that you would use these gifts to upbuild St. Mark's, Lord, in the way that you would have them be. Stretch this money, Lord, and make it meet all the needs. In your name we pray. Amen. All things come of thee.
All things come of thee,
would ask us to do. Before he comes before us, and I think all of y'all know, and if you don't know, you will know after today, that this is Alex McNeil.
Amen.
Alex McNeil. Sometimes you know him as Philip, sometimes you know him as Alex, but it's the same person. We're going to sing this little song, and everybody knows this, even the children. If they don't, they need to know it. He's got the
whole world in his hands, he's got the whole world. In his hands, he's got the whole world. In his hands, he's got the whole world. In his hands, he's got the little bitty babies. In his hands, he's got the little bitty babies. In his hands, he's got the little bitty babies. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me. In his hands, he's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands.
Amen.
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 And now, none other.
Good afternoon. Today's lesson would be humble enough to serve him. My scripture lesson will be coming from John chapter 12, and I will be reading from verses 1 through 8. Again, that's John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. In this scripture lesson, Mary anoints Jesus' feet, and that's why I like it. And it reads, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Jesus, But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 3,000 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he cared. He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put in it. Verse 7, Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." May the Lord add a blessing to his rare word. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, I stand before you, a vessel willing to be used, God. Lord, move Alex out of the way and give me what you would have me say to your people today, God. Bless each one who wanted to be here and couldn't be here. Bless St. Mark's, Lord, in a special way, God. And bless those who are here, and just let them have a good week the rest of the week. And those who may hear this message. In your name we pray. Amen. The name of my lesson is Humble Enough to Serve Him. I like this passage of scripture because Mary took what she had and blessed the Lord with it. In my line of work, I have always been a servant. That's just how it is. I am a hairstylist by trade, and then I also work with children at the YMCA. Both of those fields of work will humble you as a man. People with their hair, period, and I can't just say women anymore because men are particular about their hair too, but when it comes to a woman's hair, she's very particular about how she wants to look. And I think it's because hair is one of those things that you see when you first look at someone. You know, I know Ms. Linda by that, the burgundy color. That's just how she's worn it. And I used to work in the salon where she went. When Melvin cut all her hair, that was a big thing for her, but it was a big thing for me because I've long known her for that. But in the business of doing hair, you have to serve people. When I used to do hair at home, my mama used to fuss at me and she'd say, "Boy, you gotta learn how to talk to people." And I never understood what she was saying. If I saw the way their hair was and I ain't like it, I'd just tell them, you know, not caring. But when I got into this business, I understood what she meant. Hair is a sensitive subject with people. People are very, like I said, they're very particular about it. And I think it's the way that we portray ourselves to the world. If your hair is right and looking good, you feel 10 times better about yourself. I like it because I'm serving this client, and in serving this client, I am able to make this person feel 100 times better about themselves. And you, as the client, don't see it, but me as a stylist, you come in and you're walking kind of, "Well, Alice, I'm tired, you know." But when I get you in that bowl, and I begin to wash your hair like Mary washed Jesus' feet, I'm sure after she washed his feet and she dried it with her hair, I'm sure he felt better. I'm sure his feet were dusty and dirty from walking and doing all the things that he was put on earth here to do. But after I wash and shampoo their hair and get them looking like, as mom would say, looking like somebody, your shoulders are rear back. I feel like by Friday, every man is supposed to have a haircut. I just do. Saturday at the latest. Me, myself. By Friday, if I ain't got it together, by Friday night, I'm going to get it together. Because I'm here making everybody else look good, but me as a person, it makes me feel better too. So my topic is, are we humble enough to serve them? In being humble, we have to put ourselves aside. Being humble sometimes, me as being one of the oldest grandchildren on Clydefell's side, I'm pulled sometimes, I feel, in 15 different directions, you know? But in being pulled in those 15 different directions, those people who are pulling on me are not pulling on me from selfish reasons. They see something in me that I don't see a lot of times. So when that's the case, just like that cross, we've got to go and get plugged back up to the Lord to get a, you know, rejuvenation. And that's why we need church, and that's why we need each other. But in that pulling, sometimes we find ourselves mumbling and grumbling. Sunday mornings was one of those things as children, as teenagers, we done hung out all night, and we thought we were going to get away with not getting up for church in the morning. Well, Benita McNeil did not play that. And I learned that it was because her father was the same way. And now I'm so grateful for her dragging us to church, because our spiritual relationship with God has helped us get through some rough situations. I also do hair at Universal Nursing Home in Ramsour. So in my daily activities, I would go from working at the Y with little people to going to the totally end of the spectrum. These people are living their last days. And I've grown to love, I have a special place in my heart for children and elderly. So in a day, I'd be exhausted from working. I'd go to the nursing home first. I'd do that in the mornings. But those elderly people are so excited to see you, not just to get their hair done. A lot of them haven't seen anybody all week, or their children, who really are trying to do for them, but they live far away and they can't come but for, you know, Christmas and Easter and, you know, Mother's Day. So me and my coworker, and she made me realize that, she said, what we're going to do, it's not even about the hair. She said, we're going to love on these people just a little bit. You know, a lady down in Pittsburgh is in, you know, in all the stages of Alzheimer's. What I don't like about Alzheimer's is I couldn't imagine being trapped in my own body and not being able to communicate with you that my stomach hurts or my head hurts. This woman would just cry and cry, you know. And so me and my coworker are trying to get through, you know, getting her head in. And I said, Lord, I've got to do something to calm this woman down. And, well, I like to sing. So guess what I did? I started singing to this woman. And don't you know, before I know it, she was humming. And that was one of the songs we were singing. He's got the whole world in his head. Or I would sing, Jesus loves all the little children. Do you know that woman would come out of that Alzheimer state of mind and she would start humming that song? And you know, tears begin to roll down my face. I'm trying to get a hair roll and I'm just, I'm trying to keep singing, but I'm just, you know, just boohooing. And I'm thinking, I'm put in this situation for a reason. Yeah, I could be in New York somewhere doing hair. You know, I have a friend in Raleigh who does hair, and she fusses at me all the time. And she's like, Felix, she said, you're really good. She said, you need to be up here in Raleigh where they're paying $50 and $60 for a men's haircut. And I told her, I said, Tasha, I said, why are you off traveling the world? I said, somebody's got to be here to do home folks. You know, when I hit that age of 30, I thought, I got to get out of Asheboro. I got to get away from Asheboro. And then something nudged me one day and said, Alex, what are you running from? And then members of my family, like Aunt Janelle, Aunt Melina, Papa, and all them are getting older. And I thought, Alex, you better slow your roll, you know? And then you look at Asheboro and you say, well, Asheboro's not that far from anywhere, really. I mean, we can be in Atlanta, we can be at the beach. You know, I said, Asheboro's really not a bad place to be. And who says we can't travel? But Asheboro will always be home, you know? And one of the reasons I didn't leave was I didn't want anybody else doing Aunt Janelle's hair. I didn't want anybody else doing it. I know it's selfish, but they're my family. And if you're as a family member, you know you're going to give them the best. And I know I'm not going to charge them what everybody else was. Half the time, I wouldn't charge them anything if I wasn't in fear of getting a whooping. But, you know, so in these moments when people are pulling on you, we have to not get caught in ourselves.
Right.
Because even the business of church, especially church, where most of our church is family. Anywhere you look, St. Mark, Cox's, and Mitchell, it's family. And it's family that I've known from the time I was there, their age. Us younger generation, they are going to pull on us. And I didn't understand it. I didn't understand why Papa was so hard on us about family. And I didn't understand why Aunt Melvin was so hard on us about family, and Mama. But now I understand. Because look around. Some of these members are going on to glory, and thank God for them. So we, as the next generation and the little ones, we've got to instill those traits and those characteristics and those things. We got to get church in there. Our youth are fighting so much at school. I mean, look around. Look on Facebook. These kids are not even, these girls, teenage girls, are not dressing inappropriately. One girl was snatched up from her own yard, waiting for the school bus, you know. So pray over these children. Yes, it's important. And when they're not at church, call their mamas and daddies and grandparents and tell them, I miss you at church today, and see what's going on. You know, instilling these gospel songs, these hymns, you know, Jesus loves me, this I know. Those songs will carry you a long way. I can remember taking exams at North Carolina A&T and like, Lord, if you don't help me pass the exam, I'm not going to pass it. It was one class in between me and graduation. And I stayed in that my instructor's office, and I stayed in, and I just didn't get it. But I passed, you know. But it was prayer that helped me to stay up those late nights and study, and that dedication, you know, and say a prayer, you know. So we have to humble ourselves enough to serve others, and humble ourselves in serving others, we're serving the Lord. You know, Evangelist Jones during the Christmas season was in the nursing home. Well, Jane got in her mind, and Aunt Evelyn got in her mind, that we just need to go and see Evangelist Jones, you know. And I'm glad that they put a sense of urgency, so that next Sunday, that's what we did. A lot of times, if you just go ahead and do something and don't even think about it, it makes a world of difference to somebody. Her face lit up when we walked in that room, and you know she made us sing before we did. But that did so much to her. She had her niece there with her, which I'm sure she was happy about that too, but to see some faces from where she plays it every Sunday, and you know she misses church. So these elderly people, you know, around the Christmas season, I try to pick a mission. My mission has become the Family Crisis Center. Family Crisis Center has a special place in our heart because they helped us during some of those trying times when Daddy was trying to get it together. And thank God Daddy's got it together. But Mama knew that this situation was bigger than she could handle on her own. And y'all, counseling is not a bad thing. Daddy will ask Daddy. It will, you know, counseling is a good thing. If you feel like there's nobody that you can talk to, you feel like you need somebody who doesn't know you. Because sometimes when we talk to people who know us, they're biased. And they're, oh, girl, that ain't important. You know, just go to church and pray about it. It'll be all right. Yes, pray first. But also pray that God sends you somebody that you can talk to. But anyway, the Family Crisis Center has become a special place in my heart. So Christmas, I jump out by faith, and I go crazy when it comes to Christmas. I just can't imagine a child waking up on Christmas and not having anything. That's my heart, you know? And I'm like, even if we can get them a teddy bear or some clean underwear or some pajamas or, you know, something. Half the time, if we clean out the closet, we got plenty. So I step out on faith, and I don't think it all the way through, and I just start announcing it. And y'all know that because of our little bit and because of the back-to-school thing y'all did here, that lady sent us a nice card, and we were able to help over 100 families for Christmas. That's big. That's humongous. And the Family Crisis Center now knows who the Ashbury Charge is because of just a little bit. So when God is putting that little tugging in your heart, okay, you're a female and you like to shop. Pick a mission of battered women or young teenage girls or whatever. The Big Brother, Big Sister program. These teenage girls are needing people to look to. A lot of times they're watching us and you don't even know it. Facebook can be very ugly. So it's up to us to use it for positivity. You know, y'all who are my Facebook friends, I try to share a song every now and again. And it's usually something that's weighing on my heart. Well, you better believe when I don't post something, like now, it's time for me to post something. I'll be in Walmart minding my business, getting my groceries or whatever. Somebody who we know will come up and say, you know what, Felix? Or you know what, Alice? We ain't seen a song in a while. Or they'll post on there. So that lets me know, you know what, my little bit is going far. And then people who are my friends who live far away, who might have been going through something, they'll chime in and they'll say, you know what, Felix, how'd you know I needed to hear that? And I say, I didn't. It was just something that was in my heart. But that's, again, and sometimes Grandma Betty was telling me, when we are in our lowest state, a lot of times if we reach out and do something for somebody else, next thing you know, you feel so much better. She said, I would get low sometimes. She said, and one of my little elderly friends might need to go to the grocery store. She said, I'd go and pick them up and take them to the store. And to watch somebody like Miss Margie or somebody in the community who is having problems getting back and forth to the doctor, like John used to do. John made a living taking people back and forth to the doctor. That's his own car. That's something big. to that person who is in need and filled his void, and it would make his day. It would John helped so many people that now that he's gone, people would, you bring his name up and they'll mention, you know, that man took me to my cancer treatment or to my, you know, to my doctor's appointment or whatever. Those things become big. That is so simple to us. We were eating down at one of the restaurants in Climax, and I can't even remember. But anyway, I saw a table of three elderly people. It was a man and two women. Well, the man was sitting beside an older woman, and I couldn't figure out if the woman was his mother or his wife. I'm a people watcher. Then it was a lady who was across from them. She was like a brunette. Looks like she could have been a member of the church or whatever, but when their food came, he was feeding himself, but he was feeding that lady. And it just touched me. And you know how you look, but you're trying not to stare, because they were like just over David's his left shoulder. And he kept saying, "What are you watching?" And I said, "I'm watching this man." And so when I was forming this message, that picture came back. And I said, whoever this big burly man is, I said, whoever raised him right. I said, and he's got to have some love, some God, some Jesus in his heart, someone to sit there and feed this little lady. And I just thought it was just the sweetest, it was the most beautiful picture you could ever imagine. He didn't know it. He didn't pay no mind. He was laughing and talking with this other, but he's steady feeding his wife or his mother. And I said, now that that's not humble, then I don't know what is. So I can imagine Mary when Jesus came. She was probably excited. And she probably had that oil that she had probably saved up that money for. She had probably bought that oil. And she might have known it was going to be for something special, but she might not have known exactly what it is. And see, at Christmas, y'all, the Dollar Tree goes a long ways. People's birthdays, you say, okay, I got $5. Take that $5 and go to the Dollar Tree and pick five different items and put them together in a little basket and watch a person's face light up. And y'all, sometimes it's the most practical thing, like the little things, the Kleenexes, some smell good, some body wash. Everybody likes to smell good, you know, body wash and stuff like that, and just watch it light their faces up. So I watched that man feed that woman, and I thought, that is a Christian. That's somebody who loves that loved one. And if it was his mother, I could see him being raised up. And I'm sure they had some rough moments. But him as an adult, he said, you know what, now is my time to spoil my mama. Or if it was his wife, maybe they've had children that were, you know, grown up. And I'm sure they've had some rough times and may have not have always had everything they wanted, but God provided. So now he probably said, I made my vows before God, and now I'm going to take care of this woman. So I could see Mary, you know how women, and we do, if somebody's coming up, we straighten up. You know, I live in an apartment by myself, but when I know my sister and my mom's coming over, I'm at least straighten up. They know, they gonna know it didn't look like that always, but I could see her going to find that oil and setting it to the side. And then I could see her and Martha in there cooking and preparing a meal, because they know Jesus was gonna be tired. And then when he finally got into the house, she said, this is my moment to show love. Now, I wonder if she knew that Jesus was going to die. Jesus knew that he was going to die, but I don't know if Mary knew, but it looks like he knew that, you know? So then at the tomb, she probably used that same oil again to dress him for his final entombment. We, in this story, have to be like Mary. Mary could have used that oil for anything else. She could have sold it like Judas said, and made some money probably for the household that very much so could be needed. But do you think that the Lord is not going to bless her because she took what she had? And that's what it is. It's taking what we have. Y'all, we have gifts in us that you know about and the Lord knows about. So it's up to us to build these congregations and build these ministries to do what God would have us to do. I can't wait till the weather breaks, y'all, because that thing with the back to school thing, that was just a nudge for me to push even more. So imagine when all three of us churches coming together. Imagine the back to school blowout and the end of summer festivities that we can do for the kids. I wondered why God set me up with the YMCA for 23 plus years now in county. I wondered why he let me end as the community development director as the YMCA. And sometimes he puts you in situations that you don't think that you cut out for. I didn't know I was going to be a director. Then you get there, you're like, okay, Lord, I'm going to learn what I got to learn, and then I'm going to move on because this is not what I want. But when you do, take those tools and put it in your arsenal for what we need later. In that training, well, the George Washington Carver Enrichment Center is being built. Well, those are skills that I have, skills that together with what Mama have and what that committee have and what you have, we're going to be a mighty force to reckon with. And I love where the George Washington Carver building is being built because that side of the community, East Side, really needs us. So it's up to us. Yeah, I didn't quite grow up all the way in East Side. We live in Eula, but during the summers, that's where we were. So we've got to reach back to our community and pull forth. Again, that's putting what we need out of the way. If we make a step, God's going to carry us the rest of the way. I look at that little, like I said, that little bit of tidbit we did for the Family Crisis Center. That social worker was so elated with joy when I came over there and my little Jeep was just packed over. But she was overwhelmed, y'all, and tears began to roll down her back because she knew she could help that many more families because of the little bit that we did. Stuff that we're not using, y'all, clothes we're not wearing, dishes that we're not using. What I didn't realize is some of these people don't have anything to set their family up. They want to cook and clean for their children, but they don't have it. So we've got to stick together. What we need to remember, if you don't remember anything else I'm saying, when somebody calls your name and they really, really are in need, a lot of times they're seeing something in you that you don't see in yourself. And that's when you go to the Lord and say, okay, Lord, evidently, like today, I said, okay, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to say to these people, but I need you to give me a word because I'm going. And when you make that step, he's going to carry you the rest of the way. And then some of those things that got in your way, that supervisor that's getting on your nerves at work, that boss, that position that you know you're equipped for, next thing you know, because of you going forward, God will move some people out of the way and put you right where you need to be. So be blessed and have a good week. Let's all come to the altar. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. From the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul. Yes, Lord.